Hi, I'm James Schillinglaw, and I'm here with Avril Graham, who is actually executive fashion and beauty editor for Bazaar magazine. Now, we're not totally changing the concept for Insider Travel Report here. Avril actually has a relatively new and upcoming travel TV show. It's focused on luxury, a little upscale travel, and it is called Platinum Eye. So you'll find out about all that and more on Insider Travel Report. Now, first of all, Avril, how are you and where are you?
Well, I'm fine, surviving the year, that horrible sort of lockdown year that we've all been burrowing away, working hard. I'm in Greenwich in Connecticut, so I'm lucky to be at least in a nice leafy part of the world that I can at least go out and stretch my legs, walk and have a beach handy. Might not be the most exotic one, but I'm very, very thankful to have.
Well, we have to take what we can get these days, even if it's an exotic beach on the Long Island Sound. So we'll see what happens. Now, tell us a bit about this new travel show. We're going to amend that because you did start off in November, and we'll talk about that. And it's called Platinum Eye. First of all, where can viewers find it?
Viewers can find it on the FYI channel, which is the premium lifestyle channel of the A&E networks, which is very appropriate because it's another Hearst-owned channel.
Okay. Your magazine, Bazaar, is a Hearst magazine.
Yes. So for the last X number of years, like a lot, I've been executive fashion and beauty editor at Bazaar. And so my world is sort of dipped into sort of interesting moments along the way. I've been lucky to be the face of Bazaar in many ways. So I'm the one that will report on various different lifestyle moments that concern fashion with different TV genres. So I've been kind of lucky to do things like report from Monaco Grand Prix or opening ceremonies at Olympics.
Oh, not horrible assignments, I can tell.
That kind of thing. And it got me thinking that I never see this kind of thing on television. Like, you see the Monaco Grand Prix, but it's concentrating on the cars. Sure. There's nothing that's really concentrating on the background, the kind of behind the velvet rope moments. And another thing I do on a regular basis is I'm normally on the red carpet for Oscars. Mm-hmm. And when I go out there, I normally go to LA the week before the Oscars. And I realized very quickly that the action happens in the whole week running up. There's a nominees dinner every night. There's some fabulous event. There's always a red carpet thing. You've got every best hair and makeup person from all over the world. The jewels are flown in from all of different corners of the world for stylists to go, oh, maybe Charlize will wear that one, or maybe, you know, Uma will wear that one. And so there's an awful lot of sort of intriguing background. So with that said, my focus, I felt that there really was a bit of a gap in the market on television from beautiful travel shows that you see on PBS. Then you see wonderful travel shows imported from the UK, for example, great backpacking ones, mm-hmm. like wonderful stories of different genres. But I felt there was a little bit of a gap in the market for something that concentrated on behind the velvet rope stories, a tad of luxury, a tad of like delving into what brands were, interesting brands that you and I might have been interested in knowing a little bit more about. And also beautiful places. What makes a place beautiful? The people that live there, operate there, provide food, perhaps the mixology, all kinds of things. And that's where it really came from. I'm not a television producer.
Well, that was one of my questions was, did you have any experience before this in creating a television show?
No, funnily enough, I hadn't. And just for everybody out there, there's a way, you can do it. I've been lucky to I've always been a guest on the Oprahs, on the Today shows, on all of those like fabulous things, even Larry King back in the day. And I know what it's like to be sitting in a box waiting for that producer to say, you're on, 2 minutes, tick, tick, tick. And so I've done that, but I've never actually taken something from the beginning, nuts and bolts, and made it into a story. And it's exactly like you and I do all the time. You're weaving a story and putting it into something entertaining that you will then put in a magazine, put on a podcast, put on a YouTube special, whatever. And so my thought process behind this was to provide, I was meeting, getting back to the beginning, is I travel the country a lot for my role as bazaar editor, and I'm opening stores for big designers, I'm hosting runway shows and giving trend talks. And it got me thinking, what would the people that are watching this or listening to this or that I'm meeting, what would they watch if they're to binge watch something on a long flight on their private plane? You know, it's something that was a slight guilty pleasure that wasn't sort of like super, super high end, because I don't want it to be just people that can afford like ultra luxe things. It's for all of us who's an armchair traveler who might really be looking at like a luxe destination for a honeymoon or a celebration or something along those lines. And it formulating the stories that they might visit, that's not just the straightforward thing like going to Egypt and going straight to the pyramids. There's lots of other things you can do when you're there. So that's where I was coming from. I met a fantastic team who have taken me through the learning process of how to put it together. My idea was an idea. I didn't expect to have to be on camera, but I ended up being on camera. But it's not the me show. It's really not the me show. It's about the people that I'm interviewing.
That you meet and the people you experience things with. Yes, of course. And we have watched a few of the clips from your recent show. Just so that everyone knows, the next show is when does it start? The next season, I guess. It's later this month, right?
Well, we've been very lucky from a travel perspective. The network, we managed to shoot all 10 episodes of our show before lockdown. We finished the last one on the 28th of February last year, and then all production shut down for edits. So, but we were very, very lucky in that we'd all our creative already in the can, so it just needed to be edited. Mm-hmm. We missed our first launch date, which was last May. We couldn't have possibly have got all hands on deck to edit stuff when there was this disaster. So we had to push it back. And what we did was we put together a two episode special, which aired on the Sunday of Thanksgiving. I mean, what a joy. The network gave us a Sunday of Thanksgiving. It was just wonderful. And we'd aired two episodes, one shot at Highclere Castle, which is obviously the real Downton Abbey, where I'm going sort of behind the story of Downton, of Highclere. And then the second one we shot in Montana. And the wonderful thing about this is we've had two episodes air, and already we're number two on the network on live streaming most popular shows.
That's great. Well, people are starved for destinations. They want to see these places. And of course, it doesn't hurt you went to Downton Abbey, Highclere Castle, because that is, it's sort of, everybody thinks of an English country home or castle. That's the one they think of. And then actually Pause Up is no slouch either. It's a wonderful resort out in Montana.
And the wonderful thing about this is it's going to be an international moment. So, what might be a very familiar place to some of us might not be to someone who's sitting in China or South Korea or India or South Africa. So I wanted to bring people inside Highclere Castle to meet the Earl and Countess, who they felt like they knew them. It was wonderful experiences that we had whilst we were there, but also there was a little bit of an edgier moment. We called it Rock and Royal, and we connected the dots with it being very royal. The royal connection was we went to the Cafe Royal to get back to all of those decades where the glitterati all dined there. And even known as a bolt hole for Princess Diana, we sat at the table she sat at for lunch or had afternoon tea. We left out the back door where she would just go to escape the paparazzi. And then rock royalty was another aspect of the Cafe Royal, in that it's the very venue that David Bowie retired his alter ego, Ziggy Stardust.
Oh, wow.
So it's like rock royalty and real royalty. And, those connections of kind of making this a very much an editorial story made it fun. And with Montana, it was exactly the same thing. As a foreigner, I'm a Brit, as you can possibly tell. To me, we've grown up with cowboy movies and Wild West. This wasn't something, I still get a thrill if I see someone wearing a cowboy hat walking through Dulles Airport. I really feel like I'm on another planet. And so to actually go to real cowboy country, and ironically, some of my Scottish ancestors emigrated to that state.
From Montana.
It was just beyond. It was like a magical fairy tale to me to be able to meet all of the people that are actually making that whole area that we visited so special. And each one of them turned out to be like a fantastic star. Whether it was the girl who was working with Mustang, whether it was the guys who were like herding cattle, whether it was a chef that's going foraging 6,000 feet above seawater in the mountains, getting salsify. The whole thing was just magical.
Yeah. So, do you have sponsors for this program?
We've been very lucky. We've got, I think again, there was a gap in that programming in that, you know, this idea that it was a luxury viewer that who had good taste. So, mm-hmm. We've been very lucky. We've got amazing advertisers in the travel space, in the jewelry space, diamonds. So yes, we've got a full team working on the advertising side of things too, which is again a whole novel way of working that dynamic. I'm just learning so much more about it.
Now, what is your target viewer? You said luxury people who are luxury viewers, or maybe aspirational luxury viewers.
Yeah, both. It's you and me. It's everybody.
Okay.
You know, and I think the more that you meet people, it doesn't matter how much they have. I used to find it was interesting. People love to find out what we did at Bazaar, our lifestyles at Bazaar, because it didn't matter how much money you had. It didn't get you on a rooftop overlooking Westminster Abbey, seeing the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge getting married. So there's elements of things you can bring into people's lives that they may not experience, but not in a, oh, look at that. We're special. Right. We're here. You're not. It's much more of a, look at what there is out there and how to experience it.
Yeah. Now, obviously it is focused on upscale and luxury travel, but I sense it's a little bit, there's a difference there. How would you describe that difference? You said you're trying to meet the people behind yes. the experiences and really get to know, the people who at Downton Abbey, get to know the people at Paws Up, get to know the people at Cafe Royale who are there.
Right.
So you're really trying to do something a little different.
It's finding out the girl that it's a wonderful young woman who's probably not even 30, who's taming hundreds of Mustang at Paws Up. It's those wonderful Bedouins in the desert serving mint tea and finding what the colors of their turbans denote.
Right.
I find things like that fascinating. It's finding, we went to one of our episodes is in Morocco, and rather than do the traditional sort of, well, this is where YSL, this is Yves Saint Laurent came here after every collection, so many of his collections had inspiration from Marrakesh. What we found is we found this man in his 80s who made the first fragrances for him.
Wow.
This okay. wonderful nose who was a gardener on his estate. Those are the things to me that are interesting. I found the first guy who from Morocco who ever showed on the Paris runway, haute couture, not even ready to wear, but haute couture with very Gaga-esque style clothing. It was a revelation of finding different people. And then in every episode we have mixology and we have food preparation. So I think if it's something entertaining, a little bit of light entertainment when people are not in the best place right now, then we've done our job. If it just makes someone smile, that's a great thing.
No, absolutely.
No other ulterior motive.
Now, what's coming up on this? I think it's February 28th is the next program. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Which is actually what? Leap year, right?
Yes.
Or no, it's the day before leap year. The day before leap year, I should say.
It's a Sunday at noon. But
there
it's,
you go. And what's the topic for? Just give us a preview of what that's going to be.
Ooh, it's going to be a good one. Our very first one. You might be interested in this one.
Okay.
And we head to the headquarters of McLaren in the UK.
You got me there since I've become a Formula One fan. There's actually a series on Netflix called Formula One
That
gets you behind the scenes with all the drivers. When I was a kid, I used to be Formula One, but I sort of lost track of it, but this series got me right back into it. So yeah, McLaren out in the countryside in England. It's amazing.
Yeah.
You learn most of the teams are in England for some reason. They seem to be all over.
I know. A lot of them are, yeah. And of course, this lovely Lewis Hamilton. But we went to, I did a whole profile, actually. It was the travel aspect. It was like traveling there. It's like all about, what is this supercar? What makes people buy this kind of car? Why are people so interested in speed? How do you make it? Who designs these things? They don't just come from Mars. It's like there's a guy actually looking every curve, every detail.
Yeah.
We actually were the first to go down, first ever to film on the in their operating theater. It's like an operating theater where they actually put them together. There's not one blob of oil. There's not one screw rolling across the floor. It's literally like an operating room,
right? It's like, absolutely.
And it's fantastic. And they were so welcoming and lovely. But I looked at it in very much a lifestyle way. So it's not that I don't know what tires they use or every single model until they point them out and tell me. So it's just a lifestyle version of what of them telling their story. And then we went to the Fitzroy in Russell Square and found a few nuggets of excitement in there that were very good. And the second one, the next episode is that week before the Oscars, that running up to the run up to the Oscars. So we go for the week before Oscars, and we worked with a lot of the fabulous brands that, as I say, fly these, like the best high jewelry ends up in all corners of the world. There's gorgeous pieces in Dubai for a brand. There's gorgeous pieces in Hong Kong. But at Oscars time, the brands, whatever that brand might be, fly all of those high jewelry pieces, their best they have, their wedding cakes, and they put them on a tray in a private VIP room for people. And there's armed guards all around.
Oh, I've heard. Yeah. So, but you get to take a look at that directly, right? That's great.
Yeah. So it's all about like the shoes they wear, the comfort value of what that's about, the tricks of the trade with hair and makeup, because the makeup's got to last from your home in Mulholland down to boiling to death on the red carpet and interviews. Then you're sitting in the show, which goes on a long time. Then you've got to dance the night away for hours. So it's all of those secrets from the professionals that are putting the stars together.
No, and that's great. That's great. That's sounds again intriguing. I like the McLaren part, and I'm an old Oscar watcher, and used to live out in Hollywood for a little while, and so that was always like a national holiday when you had the Oscars for
just everything. Travel in a different way, and then we head to like La Mamounia, Morocco. Who wouldn't want to go to La Mamounia, Morocco? And so I've given you a flavor of what things that we've got there. Yeah. And our next one after that is a little bit close to my heart, in that we did a wonderful retrospective for Harper's Bazaar at the Louvre in Paris, at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs, during Paris Fashion Week last year. And it was the first time that the Musée des Arts had ever dedicated an exhibition based on a magazine. And it goes back over 150 years. Wow. So not only did they find like gorgeous pictures, which you would all know and love and recognize, but they actually had the couture outfits that we shot back in the day in their vaults. So there's a wonderful picture that Avedon took of Dovima, a wonderful model of the day, and she's in between two fabulous elephants, and she's got this amazing Dior couture gown for like the 50s. They had the gown.
So that's amazing, and you got it there. That's
So we had the outfits in many, like Shrimpton or whoever, and then the wonderful thing about that particular episode is that there was an amazing black tie affair. So the red carpet was full of fashions, AAA++ people. So every major designer of the major design houses, and it was a wonderful homage to the title I've worked on for so long. So
well, you're moving from red carpets in Hollywood to red carpets in Paris. So there's
And then we looked at the whole new version of the Lutetia. Heard lots of
I have not been there yet. I was supposed to be actually my son ended up going for his engagement. So I gave that one up to him, and sadly, and I guess I'll have to go back when it's fully open. I guess it's open now, but that's a beautiful hotel when it just opened, and I was supposed to get there. But if you've been there, now I can at least watch it and figure out what it's like.
Yeah, and I stayed at a wonderful apartment, a beautiful, fabulous apartment via the Rockshore Group, who have wonderful, beautiful private apartments all over the world, which is very nice. So there's a sort of delve into that whole Paris culture, because we talked food, we talked mixology in every single place, and everyone brings something different. So I've had people say, I wish I had a pen and paper to remember who's what mixologist is making what drink, because they're all so different. So from exotic places, like warm places like Morocco and Barbados, it's looking sort of behind the scenes there, to events. And then, we've just had wonderful escapist stories that I think will interest people. So it's like the flow of a beautiful magazine, and you can binge watch all 10 and never feel like you've seen the same thing twice.
That's great. Now obviously our audience is in the travel community, travel advisors in particular, and a lot of them sell luxury and upscale travel. How would you suggest that they use Platinum I to kind of inspire their high-end clients to travel once again? I mean, many are already, trying, but how should, when they look at this, should they refer their clients to it and say, look, take a look at this and tell me what you think, and then start to devise some travel that could be taking in some of these experiences?
Yeah, I think what we are offering is we're offering people to the opportunity to actually go and take that drink that this guy's made. We've offered the opportunity to have a look at that ceiling of frescoes that had just been revealed, and that was literally lying under 10 layers of paint since 1910 in Paris, for example. Or we're inviting them to just have that, you know, put your sequins on. And if you can afford La Mamounia, go and do it.
Okay.
We've also discovered beautiful bespoke places that people can visit that's a little bit off the beaten track. That's not necessarily, yes, go haggle for our $6, you know, tunics and things, which I have to say I came back with my suitcases bulging full of. But we also find really beautiful things that were, you know, real secrets. Secrets that Barbara Streisand found, Tom Hanks found, a little bit off the beaten track, that was a little bit more, that was much more demure, handmade, beautiful things. We found carpets that weren't your traditional Berber carpet with traditional designs, but we found the guy that's actually supplied the carpet that's in Jay-Z and Beyonce's home in Beverly Hills.
There you go.
So, and this is not your twirly usual Moroccan style, which I love and adore, but there's another aspect of modern Morocco too. I think it really opened my eyes to the point that the places that we visited, I'm dying to go back.
Go back, yeah. Well, as you and I both know, we all go to one place and we have an incredible experience, and we all want to go back. And then all of a sudden, a few years pass, and you haven't gone back yet. So you have to go. You got to remember that and do it. Now, as the show evolves, what do you hope it becomes? And again, how do you hope to keep on differentiating from other travel TV programs?
I think everybody has their own niche, and I'm not trying to like verge into anyone else's niche, because I'm not a travel person per se. I'm sort of curious, like any other traveler would be curious. You know a lot more about the genre than I do. But maybe I have a slightly different take on what I want to see when I go to a place like that. So it's, I just want to give my perspective with my editor's eye. So I say this all the time to our production crew. It's not just about capturing that sunset. It's about other things and other aspects of it.
Oh, no.
And if this is a lovely little series that can live quite happily within all the other major travel experiences, then, and we've entertained, we've done our job. And also, just to open the door, like the Moroccan Tourist Board loved it, loved what we're doing, because it wasn't just Majorel Gardens. In fact, I didn't even shoot there.
Right.
So people are probably thinking, well, what did she shoot if she didn't shoot Majorel Gardens? But I've already been there, and I've been to the museum, I've been to Saint Laurent's home, but everyone knows because that's on all the tourist lists to go, but they may not have been to the places or seen the people or even just tasted the food that we're bringing to the table. So just make it fun. And perhaps for your travel associates to say, here's where Platinum Eye went. This is what Platinum Eye did.
Right.
Why don't you try that cocktail? Like, for example, at the Cafe Royal, we not only showed the mixing of the Ziggy Stardust cocktail that they enjoyed, but we found another one from the 1930s, and the barman at the time was called Arthur Tarling, and they found it in an old barman's recipe book. You know, now that's the sort of thing that I think is quite interesting too, because it's the difference between Chanel No. 5 or the fragrance that came out yesterday.
Right.
You have the chance to enjoy both.
No, that's a great insight into these places. And I actually have been to some of these places that you're mentioning, and it is such a wonderful experience to get that history and to understand, right, you know, what happened here, whether it is a rock star in a bar or something else, or Diana at tea or something, or as you said, Formula One, how do they build those engines and everything else? So that's a lot of different focuses. Now, it is going to be on February 28th, and is there a place where I can see back it, like the ones you did in November? Now
you can still see them on the live stream.
On the live stream, so you can
and then of course it will be, you know, it'll be international as well. So if it can help any travel associate help, you know, fill the books and say, look, this is another way. I think Pause Up is pretty magical as well. It's just everything about that place. It's not a dude ranch. It's another.
No,
it's the experiences that you get. It's, you know, it's the people that have stayed there before. I was looking at it with a completely new consumer's eyes.
Sure.
Not being American, I would have been very happy if I'd flown from London to Montana, I'd land there and I was spending a fortune for 2 weeks there. I would have really felt I got my money's worth, because it's just such.
No, it is supposed to be. I have met the general managers and some other people from Pause Up several times. I just have, and they've invited me, and unfortunately, I've never been able to take advantage of that. But it is a very special place.
It's a very special place.
But it sounds like what you're trying to do is specializing in special places that are really unique and different, and getting a new take on them. So it's like a great show going forward. And now, where can travel advisors go? I know you have a website. That talks a little bit of the show, if I recall.
Yes, I mean that's really where they would go. It's like, it's, you know, you can dial up Platinum Eye, you'll be able to see it. But there's a lot of our take is slightly. I do it also with very much an international eye as well, in that we covered one which was the rebirth of luxury in Puerto Rico post hurricane.
Oh wow!
Again, I'm looking and I'm finding, you know, garden to table, I'm finding amazing fashion designers there, the local rums there. They just a slightly different take on what one would expect. And then a magical and fantastic weekend at Dorado.
Wonderful resort, amazing resort. And it's, you know, it sounds like you really, and it sounds like you just mentioned something I didn't know you'd done. And now there's probably a lot more coming down the pike later this year. But now, Avril, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with us about this wonderful new show, and good luck with it. It sounds like it already is a hit. I'm really looking forward to dialing it up in my app. Now, just once again, tell us exactly where we can find it.
It's called Platinum Eye, and it's an invitation to curated luxury, but we cover travel, fashion, culture, and the arts. And it's it airs at noon on a Sunday, it begins on the 28th of February through to the end of March, and then it forever lies on their live stream app, which is lovely. And then, of course, you'll be able to get it internationally in lots of different places.
So this is A&E, and it's the
FYI, which is their
FYI. A&E FYI. And I tell you, it's wonderful that we have this kind of great choice, but most challenging thing is finding that streaming service that you really want, and they keep coming at us in droves with more every day.
It's got the app, so that's a great way of finding it that way. But, and I hope that anyone who does tune in at least gets a little bit of fun and puts a smile on people's face. We all need it.
These days, absolutely so. And it must be of interesting to sort of launch a travel show like this in the midst of a pandemic.
Yeah, it's just a great team. And we've got a very tiny little team where it's very all hands on deck. And all I can say, another an absolute miracle is that we were traveling such a huge amount at the beginning of the year, 6 transatlantic flights within 6 weeks, 2 Caribbean and 2 domestic, and nobody managed to catch the virus until nobody.
That's great. That's fantastic.
Very, very, very fortunate.
We all missed that travel the last few months, although both you and I know I have ventured out already. So it is possible to travel during COVID, although hopefully in the next few months, it's going to get even easier to travel around. Once again, thank you very much for taking the time to speak with us, and go take a look at Platinum Eye on A&E FYI. And it's the first new program that's coming out is February 28th at noon Eastern time, right?
Cheers. Yes.
You got it. I'm James Schillinglaw, and this is Insider Travel Report.